All right. Thank you for listening this morning. You are going to hear a voice that you've heard on radio many, many times before. And you've heard her writing as well as her singing. And she is Lani Hall Alpert. She's a Grammy Award-winning singer. She has written numerous songs dating back as far as the 1960s. And I just looked at her website, and she doesn't even look old enough to be able to make that claim. She was the lead singer for Sergio Mendez's group. I used to love Brazil 66, by the way.
Yeah.
Gosh, I can hear them right now. Wow, that was our guest. Written over the course of more than 30 years. There's a book she's on the air to talk to us about. It's called Emotional Memoirs and Short Stories. And one other thing in my notes, it says that she is a survivor of the Epstein Barr virus, which I know nothing about. So it's an honor to be able to speak to her. Lani Hall Alpert, we just went to your site. Man, I know you. And I didn't know that I knew you. So,
Oh, really?
Good morning, Lani. Yes, how are you? How you doing?
I'm doing fine, Larry. I'm in New York and having a good time.
Really? Now, you don't remember me? I was the kid sitting with the cassette player and listening to Brazil 66 over.
Oh,
and
was that you?
That was me. You don't remember?
I vaguely remember this.
Oh my goodness! You guys used to take some of the great songs and rework them, and my goodness, yeah.
Yes, yeah, we did that. With Fool on the Hill, The Look of Love.
I remember that.
Help from my friends.
Oh,
we did
my
that. It was a lot of fun too.
Goodness, yes, and then of course there were the originals that you guys did.
Mm-hmm. So, Mashkinada, sure.
Mashkinada,
yeah.
By the way, are you still hearing the echo? Does it go away when you start talking on the air? I can't.
It's distant now. It's not as loud.
Oh, okay. Well, that's a big relief because I get that comment from so many of our guests. Okay, so let's start with something serious because I'm just kind of a little bit starstruck knowing that you are who you are now. What is the Epstein-Barr virus? What is that?
It's the virus that's also called chronic fatigue syndrome.
Okay. That's
Did
a virus?
Hear that?
Well, I didn't know there was
a
virus.
It's a virus, actually. It's a virus that is a little difficult to detect unless you get a certain test for it. They won't detect it through a regular blood test or, you know, it doesn't show up. But if you have a certain test for it that tests for this specific virus, then you'll know that. If you have
so
it.
So what are the symptoms? So what kind of symptoms did you
get? The symptoms change as time goes by. The symptoms are heavy, heavy fatigue that just doesn't seem to go away. You know, you wake up in the morning and you don't feel like you've gone to sleep at all. And, well, for me, it was nausea and vomiting. I had a low-grade fever all the time and my legs ached. I was freezing cold. It was like my bones were made out of ice.
Oh, wow.
And it was just over a period of, I'd say, 4 or 5 years that finally I linked it to the breast implants that I had had.
Oh, my goodness.
I think it just lowered my immune system so much that I caught this virus and... And so I had them removed.
You got them out of there. Yeah. I would,
yeah,
too.
Yeah, I got them out of there. And I never really related to them anyway, you know. I just didn't. So it wasn't a hardship for me to get rid of them. And I wrote a story in my book, actually, the last story in my book called Inland. It's all about the time that I had Epstein-Barr and took my breast implants out and...
Oh my God!
It talks about that.
By the way, I neglected to mention a very important part of this interview. You have a book, and you just referred.
I do have a book.
It's your memoir. It's called Emotional Memoirs and Short Stories. Is this brand new?
Yes. Yes, it is.
So, what was it like reliving your life? I mean, look at these credentials here. You sang "Never Say Never Again," the Bond song, the James Bond song, right?
Yeah, not with Brazil 66. That was just solo.
That was just you.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's awesome. And you speak English, Portuguese, and Spanish?
No, I speak English. I sing in Portuguese and Spanish.
Oh, really?
Wow, that's
pretty
awesome.
But I do not speak Spanish and Portuguese.
Oh, okay. Where's home? Is home Chicago?
Home is L.A., actually.
Oh, L.A.
Has been L.A. since I actually joined Brazil 66 in 1966. He was based... in L.A., and so the whole group had to live in L.A.
Okay, I gotcha. Did you guys tour a lot with Brazil 66?
We toured 11 months out of the year.
Oh, my goodness.
Wow.
Yeah, we toured. We had 1 month off. Sergio went to Brazil, and I went to Chicago, and we had 1 month off a year, and the rest of the time we were traveling or recording performing all over the world.
Now, it says in my notes that Brazil 66, and I could have told you this because I was really like the record kid, the kid who went to the records. I would study records, and I knew your records, and I knew A&M was the record label you guys were on. I could have told you that without even looking at my notes. I also know that the A in A&M is your last name, Alpert, right?
That's right. And I met Herb when Brazil 66 auditioned for A&M Records, and we got the job.
I guess so. Yeah. I think we knew that part of the story. Do you recall the audition process or the audition experience in the book?
Oh, no. I don't talk about Herb at all, except in the dedication of the book. I do not speak about him because this is a book of short stories. It's fiction and nonfiction, and it is my emotional impressions of growing up in Chicago and of my imagination. And so it doesn't really get into Brazil 66 or there's one story about singing, so I could express myself on how I feel about singing, and but it is a mixture of fiction and nonfiction with a running narrative through it that is an emotional memoir for me.
Have you formulated some of these stories because you have seen over the years other people in a similar situation, and then you might think to yourself, well, their life is like a mirror of mine at this certain time in their life at this instance?
I think that's one of the reasons I write, actually, just to connect, to make that connection. This book is full of stories that are about women who are growing out of who they are or who they were and becoming different people, and how do they redefine themselves? How do they face the challenges in their lives that they couldn't face previously and have to face as adults now? And how do they deal with relationships that constantly change?
A change is really, really good, but the woman should not forget who she is inside. I mean, she can't become somebody else.
Well, she has to keep up with herself. She can't just accept who she is when she's 25 and all of a sudden she's 35 and things that worked when she was 25 don't work anymore.
Oh, I love that observation.
It sounds like you have taken the talent that you have as a songwriter and transformed it a bit so that now it's a short story.
It is that process. It's the same process I have when I sing. When I sing, I've always been able to visually see the song unfold before me, the lyric, the story of the song.
Right.
I could see it visually, and that's how I write. I actually can see what's going on, and I also write more like a jazz musician as far as just improvisation. You know, like I'll just let the story start to take me, and I'll go with it.
Oh, really? That's interesting,
yeah.
And I love the musical comparison. Well, and to compare it to music one more in another way, when a lyricist and a composer are two different people, their work becomes better because of each other. Like the if they're both good, not always, not always. When Elton John got away from Bernie Taupin, he had a few that just didn't make it for me. So you can see, so and by the way, that was a great illustration. And I don't want to pick on any of the lyricists. You might know him. I don't want to offend you, but you know, when somebody is working with somebody, and one is the composer, one's the lyricist, you realize that when they're both good, that they're both actually making each other's work better. When you're writing, mm-hmm. when you're writing stories, you have to kind of build that on your own, don't you?
Well, it's more like a lyric is unfolding before you, you know. It, and as far as the music of it, the music is in the writing of, you know, just the way the rhythm of the words go and the harmony. It's very musical. And I mean, there's sometimes when I would write when I was writing this book, I would write a line and I would say there's a beat missing. You know, I would feel the rhythm was off,
right,
and so
right, right.
I would, you know, I would rework that until it had a rhythm to it that I thought was, you know, that I liked. So, I think all art, you know, like Herb, my husband, he's a fantastic musician, but he's also a fantastic artist. He's a fantastic sculptor and painter, and it comes from the same source. And I feel that way with writing. I feel that it comes from the same source singing comes from. So I think the arts really kind of bridge each other.
I think so, too. And it seems like that's the way artists are built. You know, I guess that's the way God made you, is to be able to do that. Let me just reintroduce you, Lani. Lani Hall Alpert is our guest. And you don't always use Alpert, or sometimes you do and sometimes you don't?
Well, I felt that when I use Lani Hall as a singer, because I started my career as Lani Hall, and
right.
I didn't want to confuse. But for writing, I was married by the time I started really writing these short stories, and
okay.
I felt that I should make that distinction.
Yeah, yeah. Emotional memoirs and short stories. If you're just tuning in, you know who Lani Hall is. Lani Hall Alpert is one of the vocalists from Brazil 66, Sergio Mendez and Brazil 66. When he went on, like every decade, it was like Brazil 77, Brazil 88.
Yeah.
Were you part of those groups as well?
No, when I left the group, that's when Sergio changed the name of the group. So I'm the Brazil 66 part.
And that, my own opinion, no offense to the other ladies, but that was the group.
Yeah.
That was the group. Everything else was Menudo 2, Menudo 3. I don't know. I mean, I'm sure they were fine.
Yeah.
No offense to anybody out there, but that was, and maybe it's because I was at that age at that time, you know, whatever age, I would have been 15 or whatever it was.
Yeah, well, most of his, we just did a concert. Herb and I just did a concert with Sergio at the Hollywood Bowl. And when we came out and I sang a couple of songs with Sergio as well as with our group that we have. And you know, all those hits, you know, the Fool on the Hill and The Look of Love
right,
and
right.
Like a Lover and Mashkinada. Just there's so many that were with Brazil 66. So those are kind of the identifiable songs.
Right. How many other ladies were there in that group?
When I was with them?
Yeah.
I was the lead singer, and while I was with him for the 5 years, there were three other women that sang with me at different times. So
okay.
There were always two of us on stage to, you know, have a nice double sound coming at you. But
okay, and so in the studio?
On records, I doubled my voice on the
record. That's
records.
What I was going to ask you. Oh, wow. Well, that was a signature sound. I never realized that. For some reason, I thought that the records were several singers. It was you.
Well, I tried to sound different on each little solo within each song. I tried to sound like I was.
I can hear you in my head right now. I'm hearing you.
He's your fan.
I'm telling you, I used to listen to you endlessly. I had no idea. Well, so what did Sergio do?
Yeah.
What was his job?
He's a piano player, I think.
Oh, man. Oh, wow.
He's a great piano player.
By writing your memoir and doing your life observations, you are becoming a subliminal mentor to the younger generation, because you're giving them hope and you're giving them courage to stand on their own two feet and to think of themselves, well, if there is something that they feel just isn't quite right about themselves, they'll be able to fix it and be successful.
Well, you know, I put this one story inland that we were talking about before, about when I had Epstein-Barr virus. I put that at the end of the book because so many of these women in these stories are searching for their own voice. And in this story, in this particular story of Inland, that's what I did. I actually got in touch with, okay, all these doctors aren't helping me. You know, I need help. Who am I going to ask? And I decided I'm going to ask myself. And I started tapping into that wisdom within myself that everyone has, and found the truth of, wow, you know, what I needed to do
in order to be
healthier.
Nobody but you figured out that it was the breast implants.
Well, no. At the time, things were starting to come out in the news. Things were doing, you know, women with breast implants are starting to have autoimmune dysfunctions. And All of a sudden, I was looking at the news thinking, wow, you know, I wonder if it's the breast implants. And, you know, I called the doctor that put them in, and I said, you know, well, what's with this? And he said, oh, no, these are hysterical women, you know. And
Did you call him back after you got rid of him?
I actually didn't. I went to his office and said, I want you to take these out, and I don't want you to take them out with anesthesia, I said, because I was terrified of going under with anesthesia and starting that whole process of dizziness and vomiting again that I had been through with for years before, and I just couldn't face doing that again. And I said, I don't want to get dizzy, and I don't want to be nauseous, and I want you to take them out without anesthesia.
Wow. Didn't it hurt?
And he said, you know, well, I haven't done that since med school. And I said, well, can you do it? And he said, I could try, and I don't know if you're going to be able to handle it, but, you know, let's try.
So he did he numb you in any way?
Yes. Oh, yeah, of course. Yeah. Yes. Yes, he numbed me. But once he really was painless. I really didn't feel anything until he had to start cutting the scar tissue off of the chest wall.
Oh.
That was bad. That was bad. I almost said, okay, give me anesthesia. But
Wow.
I just held off, you know, as long as I could, and I did, and that was the end of that. I wouldn't do that again.
And the symptoms from the Epstein Barr made you depressed?
Well, I mean, you were walking around in a brain fog. Right. I don't even think I.
You sound so happy though.
You can't function as a normal human being.
Did I ask how long ago this was? I mean, this wasn't when you were singing, was it? Or, I mean, you've always been singing.
This was when I was singing in South America and Latin America, and I had just won a Grammy Award for the album that I had done in Spanish at the time, and I had just won a Grammy Award, and I was in bed all day for the in order to just get the energy to go to the Grammys that evening, and that was pretty much the last I didn't sing for 10 years after that.
Wow. Oh my!
You know, I know this is just because I'm a dopey man, but I'm always thinking when a woman gets a breast implant, does she, after she's done, look at her profile in the mirror, and go, man, there I am, all that, and I.
Well, you know, I think probably the majority of people do. I looked at myself and I felt like I didn't feel right. It didn't feel right to me. And it didn't feel like this was me. I mean, when I would catch myself, my reflection in a mirror or a window, I wouldn't recognize who that was, you know, because I didn't see myself as having these breasts. And I never really bonded with them. I really felt like I was wearing them.
Well, you know,
maybe they were wearing me. You know,
and if part of this whole human experience is to be liked, and if we as a culture make women feel like to be liked, you have to be have this certain look. I'm going to be honest with you. I don't think I ever saw one photo of you in all those albums that I had. Well, you weren't on the cover, or you were hidden or something? You weren't covered in whipped cream, were you?
I was on the cover.
Oh.
You were? Let me find you. Yeah. Okay, how come I don't remember? But I fell in love with you, you know.
Yeah.
By listening to you. Hold on. Let me find it. Let me find those covers.
He is a huge fan.
Huge fan. Wait, I'm looking up the wrong thing.
I'm getting that feeling.
Sergio Mendez covers. Hold on. Let me look first.
And he had all the albums. I mean, it wasn't just cassettes. It was real albums.
Just put in Brazil 66, though.
Oh, yeah. I see it.
Because if it's not Brazil 66, it's not going to be me.
I remember this. Sergio Mendez in Brazil 66. Now, there he is in the front. Who do you always remind me of? You remind me of somebody. Which one are you? Are you the blonde? There's three guys.
No. I'm the brunette.
You're the one in front. The one that looks like Mona Lisa.
Yeah, I'm not sure which album you're looking at.
It says greatest hits on it.
I guess you could say, yeah, I look like Mona Lisa.
Yeah, you're beautiful.
No, most of these covers have Sergio on them. Okay. There's enough.
Well, it's his first. His name is first.
His name. Yeah. Well, what an honor to be able to say we spoke to you today. I don't know if you can tell when somebody downloads iTunes. You got them coming. Because I haven't had these in so long. You know, it's like I'm rediscovering old music again because I don't have the records anymore. I gave them to another radio station that I worked at.
Yeah.
So I will be downloading them, and you'll see the numbers go up. You'll say, hey, look at that. Larry is buying my records.
Larry, I'll say.
All right, so now I hope we've been fair to the book. It's called Emotional Memoirs and Short Stories. It's written by our guest, Lani Hall Alpert. And let's see, you have the website I went to is lanihall.com. Herbal? Com. What is it? Herbal?
No. It's Herb Alpert Presents.
Oh, Herb.
But if you just put in LaniHall.com, that's it.
I gotcha. I thought it said herbal. Yeah. See how websites are? They put one. What is this? Herbal Presents? Yeah. Herb Alpert Presents. Okay, so just put LaniHall.com.
LaniHall.com, but you should, Larry, if you liked Brazil 66, you should get our new album. It's called Steppin' Out, and you'll like that. Cause
by you?
Remember the song, It's All in the Game?
Oh, I love that song.
Yeah, we recorded it. How does it go? It's just wonderful. You'd like that one, too.
Can you remind?
Try that one.
Can you sing a little bit? How's it go?
I really need the piano, but don't you remember it? You know, many a tear has to fall, but it's all in the game. Remember that song?
Of course. Yeah. I just wanted to hear you sing.
Lani, it's beautiful.
That was awesome.
That was so cool.
I just got Lani Hall to sing me a personal little line.
Yes, and he is going to say that. He's got it on tape. He will use that.
What's the new album called?
Stepping out.
Oh, I see it on here. Okay. I just went to your website. There it is. Stepping out.
He's going to buy it right now.
Oh, that's Herb's album.
Herb Alpert and Lani Hall.
Okay. You got to put your name first on some of these things. All these men keep upstage.
I'll work on it.
You really do give hope to everyone because you have had much success and then you have had changes in your life that had to do with adversity and now you're back out there again and that is really to be admired in your strength.
Thank you, Robin. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Wow, you made my day. I had no clue. When I was looking at these notes, I was just in the dark for some reason about this. Lani Hall Alpert, thank you so much for being on the air with us today.
It's my pleasure, Larry.
I hate saying goodbye. For the listeners, LaniHall.com, get the album, make her numbers go up, and remember, you've heard her for all of your life.
Yeah.
You've been listening to her all of your life. Lani, thank you for being on the air. It's an honor, and what a fun interview, too, by the way.
It was fun for me, too. Thank you.
All right, you're welcome. We'll take a break. Be right back.